Before I really go into my sermon here tonight, I think we all know that the theme of the camping is perfection of character. And I hope that each one of us will seriously consider the concept of the perfection of my character. Well, I want you to consider my character, it's true. But I want you to think about this in the first person, the perfection of my character. Let's not be as worried about the perfection of someone else's character this week. I mean, that needs to be done, I know. But let the Lord and that person work it out. But let's be concerned about me, O Lord. I'm the one standing in the need of prayer. Isn't that right? That's right. I'd like to invite you to open your Bibles to the 7th chapter of Daniel. Daniel chapter 7, we're going to begin reading in verse 9. Daniel chapter 7 and verse 9. The prophet writes, I beheld till thrones were cast down, or as one revised version says, placed. And the Ancient of Days did sit, whose garment was white as snow, and the hair of his head like the pure wool. His throne was like the fiery flame, and his wheels as burning fire. A fiery stream issued and came forth from before him. Thousands ministered unto him. 10,000 and 10,000 times 10,000 stood before him. The judgment was set, and the books were opened. I beheld then because of the voice of the great words which the horn spake. I beheld even till the beast was slain, and his body destroyed and given to the burning flame. As concerning the rest of the beast, they had their dominion taken away, yet their lives were prolonged for a season and a time. I saw in the night visions, and behold, one like the Son of Man came with the clouds of heaven and came to the Ancient of Days, and they brought him near before him. I'd like to propose to you that this is one of the most solemn instances of all the Bible, one of the most solemn scenes ever given in the Bible. This is the beginning of the investigative judgment in heaven. And it's a solemn, solemn time. A few years ago, I had an opportunity to go to the United States Supreme Court to hear a couple important cases. And if you've never been to the United States Supreme Court, you would find it a very, very interesting event. It's not like going into magistrate court. It's not like going into the normal courtroom that you probably have ever been in your life. It will be one of the most solemn events you will ever experience. You will be instructed, not so much how you will act in the court if you go as an observer, but how you will not act. And that is that you will make absolutely no noise. You got a cold? You don't go. You might cough? You don't go in. Children? Don't go in. Babies never go in because they might cry. Everything is totally silent when you enter into that chamber. And as you are sitting, waiting on the judges or listening to the oral arguments, there are guards. Large, strong guards in uniform, wearing white gloves. And they are pacing up and down the aisles, and they are just looking at people. And they don't have a very pleasant demeanor upon their face either. And their face is saying something to the effect of, don't you dare make a peep of noise of any kind. Don't get a camera out. Don't record this. Nothing. The oral arguments at the Supreme Court last 1 hour, usually. Sometimes there are exceptions. Generally, there's an hour. And one thing I thought was very interesting. One of the cases I was on, one of the lawyers was starting to make his final closing talk, and then the little buzzer rang. The time was up. And just as soon as the buzzer rang, then Chief Justice Rehnquist said, that's it, it's over. And before I realized it, he and all the other justices had passed through that red curtain in the back, and they were gone. Didn't matter if that man had more to say. It was over. When the time came for it to be done, it was over. And friends, the judgment is about over. And when it's over, it's going to be over, and it's going to be too late. And how will we fare on that day? What will our characters be like? We have automobiles, we have houses, we have clothes. We won't take any of it to heaven.
None.
Only our characters. And friends, if we don't have perfection of character, we won't be taking it. We won't be going. When you go into a courtroom, there are certain legal terms. And if you don't understand these legal terms, it's very hard to follow along. For instance, do you know what an abstract of judgment is? Do you know what it means to adjudicate? Or do you know what a deposition is? How about the term expungement? Or habeas corpus? You've heard that one a lot, I'm sure. How about interrogatives? Or prima facie. Do you know these terms? What do they mean? If you don't know these or other terms and you have to go to court, probably should get an attorney. But what we're talking about this camp meeting, friends, has terminology. And tonight I want to begin by talking about some of the terminology, because if we don't understand what we're talking about, how can we thoroughly contemplate it? How can we understand it, not only intellectually, but experientially? Because what we're talking about tonight is not a small issue. This is not chump change. This is a big deal. It's a real big deal. We've been told those who would share the benefits of the Savior's mediation should permit nothing to interfere with their duty to perfect holiness in the fear of God. The precious hours, instead of being given to pleasure, to display, or to gain seeking, should be devoted to an earnest, prayerful study of the Word of Truth. The subject of the sanctuary. The subject of what?
Sanctuary.
The sanctuary. And the investigative judgment should be clearly understood by the people of God. All need a knowledge for themselves of the position and work of their great high priest, because she says otherwise, it will be impossible for them to exercise the faith which is essential at this time or to occupy the position which God designs them to fill. Every individual has a soul to save or to lose. Each has a case pending at the bar of God. Each must meet the great judge face to face. How important then that every mind contemplate often the solemn scene when the judgment shall sit and the book shall be opened, when with Daniel every individual must stand in his lot at the end of the days. The Great Controversy, page 488. We're talking about perfection of character. It's not a small thing, is it? In fact, friends, I think that understanding this and understanding how it connects to the sanctuary is a salvational issue.
Yes.
If what she says is true, it becomes a salvational issue, at least if you're going to be a part of the 144,000, friends. Now, I want to ask you a question. Do you really think, do we have a basis for saying that God indeed requires perfection of character, especially of this last generation? Can we vote confidently that the Bible indeed teaches this? Without any question, I think we can. In Matthew chapter 5 and verse 48, Jesus is speaking here, and that's a pretty good authority. And he says, "Be ye." Now, ye is what kind of a pronoun?
Second person
plural. All of us. But be ye what? Perfect. Even as your Father in heaven is perfect. Well, Brother Terry, I don't know how perfect God is, but I think it's about as perfect gets. Isn't it?
Yeah.
That's what it says. In Colossians chapter 1. I'll begin reading in verse 27. to whom God would make known what is the riches of the glory of this mystery among the Gentiles, which is Christ in you, the hope of glory, whom we preach, warning every man and teaching every man in all wisdom, that we may present every man, what?
Perfect
in Christ Jesus. Are there any exceptions? He says, we teach this to everyone. And we want to do this so that every person can be presented perfect before Jesus Christ. James chapter 1. James chapter 1 and verse 4. We'll read verse 3 for the context. Knowing this, that the trying of your faith worketh what?
Patience.
Oh, Anne, God has given you to me, and me to you, that this verse might be fulfilled in our lives. But it says, let patience have her what? Perfect work, that ye may be perfect and entire, wanting
nothing.
Nothing. Beloved, can we believe the naked word of God tonight? Do we have to add to it? Do we have to take away from it? Can we believe it for what it says? Several years ago, I met A.T. Jones and E.J. Wagoner. I met them through reading their books and their writings. Maybe you have too. I hope you have. And there's been a lot of controversy over what the 1888 message is. It depends on whose book you pick up or whose magazine you subscribe to the view you have of what the 1888 message is. But I want to tell you what the 1888 message is for Allen Stump. It was that I could accept God's word and really believe it and accept those promises. That was the one theme that I saw throughout everything that Jones and Wagoner wrote in those times. That I could accept God's word for what it said. It was true and it was faithful. And it is, friends. It most surely is. In Genesis chapter 17, we have a command. Genesis chapter 17 and verse 1, a command that God gave to Abraham. And I don't think any of us have got quite this far yet, although Arlene's getting close here. But it says, and when Abram was 90 years old and nine, 90 years old and nine, when he was 99, the Lord appeared to Abram and said unto him, I am the Almighty God, walk before me and be thou
perfect.
Be thou part of the way. So what it says? It says it were to be perfect. Now, I probably add something to the verse there. I need to be careful. He said to Abraham, be perfect. But may I remind you that in Acts chapter 10, verse 34, the Apostle Peter says, I perceive that God is no what? Respecter of persons. In other words, if he expects perfection from Abraham, does he expect perfection from me? Absolutely. Absolutely he does. Let's go back to the New Testament again, to 1 Peter chapter 1. We're going to drive this now, we're going to sink it a little deeper, and then we're going to get us a nail set, and we're going to set it a little deeper yet, to make sure. 1 Peter. Peter comes after Hebrews and James. 1 Peter chapter 1. I'm going to read verses 15 and 16. It says, but as he which hath called you is holy, so be ye holy in most of your life, in all the most of the things you do. In all manner of conversation. Now Thomas knows, he studied the Greek on this, that word conversation means lifestyle. It doesn't mean just simply and only what we say. In all your deportment, everything that you do. It says, because it is written, be ye holy. Why? For I am holy. Can two walk together except they be agreed?
No.
Do you think God wants to walk together with us someday through the pearly gates? I think so. I think he wants to walk with me in the earth made new sometime up a beautiful field with some daisies and other flowers. Maybe some asters and hollyhocks and snapdragons. Violets. But we can't walk together unless we're agreed, friends. And if I'm unholy and he's holy, we're not going to take that walk together. And you will not either. Hebrews chapter 6 and verse 1. Hebrews chapter 6 and verse 1. Therefore, leaving the principles of the doctrine of Christ, let us go on unto what?
Perfection.
There are basic fundamental principles of our Christian experience, friends, but then we are to go beyond those basic fundamental principles on to perfection. Now, there's a principle that we're going to apply tonight to some of these texts. In fact, I think it probably is going to be applied all week long by the various speakers. And I'm just hoping and praying that the Lord will, and already has, laid it upon the hearts of the different presenters to speak a variety of aspects and messages that will dovetail together so that we will have a good picture of what we're looking at collectively when we leave here. But there's a principle I want to apply this week and begin by applying it tonight. It's found in the book Christ's Object Lessons on page 333. It's very simple. All His biddings are enablings. Do you understand what that means? When God bids us to do something, when God gives us a command, He gives us what? The power to fulfill that command. How many times? Every single time. Every single time. Also in Christ's Object Lessons on page 315, we are told that God requires perfection of His children. Boy, that's a high standard, isn't it? Isn't that a high standard? But think about it for a minute, friends. Would you really be satisfied with a low standard? Would you really be happy if God was going to fill His church with unconverted drunkards, unconverted harlots, where there was no standard and anyone could just live and be any way they wanted? Would you really want to be in a church like that? I wouldn't. No, I want to be in a church that has high standards, friends, all across the board. I'm not afraid of them. I want them. And I think God wants us to want them. In the book Child Guidance, on page 477, the Lord requires perfection from His redeemed family. He expects from us the perfection which Christ revealed in His humanity. That's a pretty perfect too. Be ye therefore perfect, even as your Father which is in heaven is perfect, Matthew 5:48. But here we're told that we're to have the same perfection that Christ had in His humanity. And that was pretty perfect. You probably have heard this statement before, or one very similar to it. It's in Patriarchs and Prophets, page 574. And it says, as God is perfect in His sphere, so we are to be perfect in our sphere. And sometimes we hear that and we think about that. All that means, well, you know, God's got a pretty big sphere, right? And He's a pretty big guy. He's a pretty powerful, awesome individual. And God's perfection that He expects from Himself is far greater than the little perfection, because my sphere is very small, see. But have we ever read the context of this statement? Let's read the context of the statement, could we? In the same book, Patriarchs and Prophets, page 574, success in this life, success in gaining the future life, depends upon a faithful, conscientious attention to the little things. The little things. Perfection is seen in the least, no less, than in the greatest of the works of God. The hand that hung the worlds in space is the hand that wrought with delicate skill the lilies of the field. As God is perfect in His sphere, so we are to be perfect in our sphere. When we learn to make a bed, and I would suggest that we should learn to make the bed every day, there's a certain amount of character that's developed in making a bed and making it well, or cleaning the counter properly, changing the oil properly, because that's part of my sphere and it's part of your sphere. You know, you don't have to worry about keeping Jupiter in line. That's part of God's sphere. God will keep the planets where they need to be. But I have things in my sphere, friends. And part of my character development comes from doing the little things well. Continuing in the youth instructor of January 17, 1901, we are told that God's work is perfect as a whole because it is perfect in every part, however minute. He fashions the tiny spear of grass with as much care as He would exercise in making a world. And friends, if you don't believe that, look at that tiny blade of grass under a microscope. Look at it under a microscope. You know, I find something interesting, and that is that when I take things that God has created, and the more I magnify them, the more closely I examine them, the more beautiful and more perfection I see in them. But if I take anything that mankind has made, you take this plastic tablet, you take anything that we've made, and the more you examine it, you know what you see? More imperfections. You see more imperfections. This is called the Pita. I'm not sure if that's pronounced right, but it's a name for the statue that Michelangelo made of Mary and Jesus. And I've been to the Vatican. I've seen this up close in person. I'm going to tell you, as beautiful as it looks on the screen, as beautiful as it looks in pictures, it's even much more beautiful when you see it in person. Because the details are so perfect in it. I've been in the Sistine Chapel. And someone once asked Michelangelo, "Why are you painting it so exact and so minutely detailed?" He's laying on his back on a scaffold up there painting, you know. Because it's high, it's not a low ceiling like here, it's pretty high up there. No one will see it. He says, "I see it. I see it." And of course, God sees it. "Trifles," said Michelangelo, when a friend thus characterized the slight finishing touches he was giving to a statue. He said, "Trifles make perfection." And that's no trifle. That's no trifle. This is an important subject. We have been told in Desire of Ages on page 671, the very image of God is to be reproduced in humanity. The honor of God, the honor of Christ is involved in the perfection of the character of His people. There's something about the honor of God and the character of God that is vindicated by the perfection of God's people. And without it, God's honor, friends, can't be substantiated in the universe. Isn't that something to think about, that you have something to do with bringing honor to God and to His character to the universe? We'll talk more about this Friday. Now, I said at the beginning we would be talking about some terms. I want to talk about some terms now. We're here to discuss perfection of character, and perhaps it might be best to discuss what these terms mean. Very simply, we don't have to make this hard. Perfection is simply the state of being perfect. Perfection is the state of being perfect, but of course, then that begs the question, what is perfect? Well, perfect is defined in different ways. Generally, we think of perfect as being as good as possible or free from faults. That would be what the dictionary might say. But let's look at the Bible and let's see how the Hebrew and the Greek writers used words that we today translate as perfect. And let's turn first to Genesis chapter 6 and verse 9. Genesis chapter 6 and verse 9. It's about Noah. These are the generations of Noah. Noah was a what? Just man and perfect in his generations. And Noah walked with God. Remember we said you can't walk with God unless you agree with Him? Is God perfect? Since he was a just man. This Hebrew word that's translated perfect, tam, means to be complete, sound, or without blemish. This is a little pie chart that shows how this Hebrew word is translated throughout the Old Testament. It's translated 44 out of, I believe, 91 times without blemish, but it's also translated several times perfectly, several times uprightly, without spot, whole, sound, complete. These are some of the ways that the translators have tried to translate this word to give you an idea of this concept that this word carries to us. Now, there's another very interesting word, and it's very similar to a Hebrew word that you know. If I said shalom, would you know what it means? It means peace. But this is a Hebrew word, shalom, which is just basically just like shalom almost. It means to be sound or complete, to be put at peace or in harmony. I can show you a few places it's used. 1 Kings 8:61, And by the way, I'll bring you that other verse later, if tomorrow, whenever I get back, but we'll find it. 1 Kings 8:61. David is speaking to Solomon here. He says, let your heart therefore be what? Be perfect with the Lord our God, to walk in his statutes and to keep his commandments as at this day. And it's this Hebrew word shalem. Another place is in Isaiah chapter 26 and verse 3. Sorry about that. It says, thou wilt keep him in what? Perfect peace. Shalom, shalom. It's like having two shaloms together almost. You're at a state of perfection with God so that you're at peace with him. You don't have these worries, you don't have concerns because you know that you are in harmony. I've mentioned to some of you before that in some languages of the world, like French or Spanish, maybe German, I'm not sure Elvis can help me on that one. But there's no equivalent of the English word atonement. No equivalent of the English word atonement. The best that they have means to expiate or to appease. But we have this word atonement. And sometimes when I'm trying to explain this concept from a biblical standpoint, I talk about harmony. How you have maybe, for instance, two tuning forks or two strings of an instrument, how they vibrate together and they make harmony together. Atonement means to be at one with God, to be at harmony with God, to be at peace with him. And when we have that, we are experiencing what the Bible speaks of as perfection. In the New Testament, we read Matthew chapter 5 and verse 48 earlier, be ye therefore what? Perfect even as your Father which is in heaven is perfect. And by the way, here's the use of shalem in the Old Testament. I should have showed you that first. But you see, most of the time it's translated perfect or perfected, but it can mean whole, peaceable, just, quiet, etc. But in the New Testament, we have this word teleos, and it's translated in Matthew chapter 5, verse 48, perfect, and it means to be complete, or something that has reached its end, or that has become mature. Another example of it is in 1 John chapter 4 and verse 18, if you would turn there with me. 1 John chapter 4 and verse 18. It says, there is no fear in love, but perfect love. Perfect love casteth out fear, because feareth torment. He that feareth is not made, what? Perfect in love. Perfect love, mature love, complete love. This is the concept. And then we have another Greek word, katartizo. But it means the state of completion. The word is common for mending broken things or nets, Matthew 4:21, or even men. Remember when the fishermen were mending their nets? This is that word. It's also translated perfect. It means they're mending it together, putting it together, patching it up. Robertson Ward's Pictures of the New Testament says, so it is a long process to get the pupil patched up to the plane of his teacher, patched up. Or to get him mature, to get him perfected to the place of his teacher. As I read these verses, and there are many, many more we could look at tonight, but these are some of the main words that are translated perfect in the Bible. The sum of Scripture for perfect then means to be free from guilt. It means to be mature. It means to be complete. It means to be finishing. It means to be sound. It means to be at peace and in harmony with God. In other words, atonement. Keeping the commandments is not a definition of perfection, but it is a result or the fruit of the maturing or the completing process. It is the fruit that something has happened in our lives. And without it, there's no perfection, friends. Now we're talking about perfection of character, and that's the other half of this phrase, character. Who can tell me the only place in the Bible that the word character is used? Somebody remember? Well, that's good. You're a good class, because there's no place in the Bible you find, and at least in the King James translation, no place in the Bible do you find the word character. Is that right? That's right. But is the concept of character taught through the Bible? Of course it is. But I want to show you an interesting text in the book of Hebrews. If you'll turn with me to Hebrews chapter 1 and verse 3. Hebrews chapter 1 and verse 3. Speaking of Jesus, it says, who being the brightness of his glory and the express image of his person. The express images of whose person?
God.
Of God's person. You know, this phrase, express image, it's from a Greek word. And if you translate this Greek word, it's character. The character of his person, or his hypostasis. It's the closest thing to character we have, literally, in the Bible. And so when we see Jesus, Jesus said, when you see me, you've seen what? The Father. But was he talking about a physical image? No. But he was talking about the character. When you've seen me, you've seen the character of the Father. The character is what we are on the inside level. In fact, we've been told in Child Guidance on page 161. True character is a quality of the soul revealing itself in the conduct. It's a quality of the soul, the quality of the inner being, but it's revealed then how? In our conduct, in the way that we live. Now, in upward looking, going to the next slide where we were just a minute ago, Ellen White says, never forget. It means you should remember it, right? Never forget that thoughts work out what? Actions. Repeated actions form habits, and habits form character. And that's why young people and old people alike, we should make that bed every morning when we get up. Because it's an action, and that action creates a habit, and that habit starts to form character. But you know what, friends? Just assured you're not doing the things that you know you should be doing. You're forming habits, and that's forming a character too, isn't it? It sure is. So all these things play together. But it begins by, it says, that we have the right thoughts. Thoughts work out actions. Thinking right is, friends, of the utmost importance. In Desire of Ages on page 311, we've been told that the ideal of Christian character is Christ-likeness. As the Son of Man was perfect in his life, so his followers are to be perfect in their life. So does this really matter to us as Seventh-day Adventists? Seventh-day Adventists. What does the term Adventist mean? We're looking for the coming of Jesus, right? Let's turn to 2 Peter chapter 3. And I want you to look at a text that Adventists have, I believe the right understanding of, but probably to a great degree a pretty unique understanding of compared to most other churches. 2 Peter chapter 3, verses 11 and 12. He says, seeing then that all these things shall be dissolved, what manner of persons ought you to be in all holy conversation and godliness? Remember that word conversation means all your lifestyle. Now verse 12, looking for and hastening unto the coming of the day of God, wherein the heavens being on fire shall be dissolved and the elements shall melt with fervent heat. What does this mean, hastening the day of the Lord? You mean that we can actually have something to do with making that day sooner?
Amen.
That's exactly what it says. In fact, another translation of it says this. Since all these things are thus to be dissolved, what sort of people ought you to be in lives of holiness and godliness, waiting for and hastening the coming of the day of God? Friends, it behooves us to take this matter of character perfection seriously, because we can hasten or we can delay the coming of the Lord. And the very fact that we are all alive today is because someone else was delaying the coming of the Lord before we were ever born. The truth is that the Advent movement was designed to take the people to the heaven a long time ago. And we're here today, and the question is, how many of us are going to become grandparents and great-grandparents that don't need to be? But because of this principle, we read something in Christ's Object Lessons. I know you've heard it before. It's on page 69. When the character of Christ shall be perfectly reproduced in his people, then he will come to claim them as his own. So, when probation closes in the heavenly sanctuary, friends, that's not an arbitrary decree. It's not a fixed date that God has put on his celestial calendar. And it's going to happen whether we're ready or not. Here he comes. close of probation, friends, is going to be directly linked to the development of the character of God's people. And what we are seeing now, remember we said that one of the concepts of perfection is a maturing process? You know, when do you pick a good tomato? You pick it when it's green and small in the vine? You pick it when it's ripe. And the best place to eat it is in the garden, right? When you first pick it. God's looking for a people to become mature, where the character of Christ is fully, perfectly reproduced in those people. And then probation is going to close because, friends, those people are still and they're ready. But on the other hand, there's a polarization happening at this same time. There's a polarization happening. And there's a group of people who are becoming more Christ-like, and there's a group of people who are becoming more wicked. And they're going to become so wicked that they will put God's people to death and they think they're doing God's service.
That's right.
And so when the character of Christ shall be perfectly reproduced in his people, then he will come to claim them as his own. Now, I think before we quit, there's some things that we need to talk about too. And one section is, what perfection of character is not. When you know what character perfection isn't. Well, one thing is, it's not total health. If you happen to be sick, it doesn't mean that you can't have character perfection. There are people who are born sick, people who are born blind, people who get bit by flies and have problems and all kinds of issues. And it doesn't mean they're bad people. Don't look down on someone because they don't have good health. It doesn't mean they can't have character perfection, friends. Because we're talking about perfection of character, not perfection of body. It doesn't mean that we either have perfect mental health or intelligence. There are people who have issues with their mental health. And people who just aren't as sharp on the block as others. Like, you know, I get behind a lot on some things. Maybe you do too sometimes. But it doesn't mean that we can't have a perfect character. And then always, correct spiritual or non-spiritual judgments. Do I buy car A or car B? Well, I bought car A. It was a lemon. I wasn't perfect. You know, should I have an evangelistic meeting in town A or should I have an evangelistic meeting in town B? Well, we went to B and we didn't have any baptisms. It was a bad decision. I wasn't perfect. That's not Christian character perfection either, friends. We may make mistakes in judgment. We may not understand everything perfectly well. But that's not what it is. Maybe you've heard of something called perfectionism. Have you ever heard of this term, perfectionism? It's a state of perfection in the flesh to where we become no longer capable of sinning. And this was something that came in to the Advent people shortly after 1844. Some of the people there lost hold on God and they drifted into fanaticism. Ellen White, she met these extremists with a plain, "Thus saith the Lord." She rebuked those who taught a state of perfection in the flesh and that therefore they could not sin. And I'll just show you what she said about it. They held that those who are sanctified cannot sin and thus naturally led to the belief that the affections and desires of the sanctified ones were always right, and never in danger of leading them into sin. In harmony with these sophistries, they were practicing the worst sins under the garb of sanctification. And through their deceptive, mesmeristic influence, were gaining a strange power over some of their associates, who did not see the evil of these apparently beautiful but seductive theories. Let me just pause for a minute. Friends, there are some theories out there, and some of them look very beautiful. They look great. They sound sweet. But they're seductive and they're sophistries of Satan. Continuing, she says, "Terrible was their power over the people, for while holding their attention and winning their confidence through a mesmeristic influence, they led the innocent and unsuspecting to believe that this influence was the Spirit of God." We hear that today too, by the way. "Therefore, those who followed their teachings were deceived into the belief that they and their associates who claimed to be wholly sanctified could fulfill all the desires of their hearts without sin." Clearly, the deceptions of these false teachers were laid open before me, and I saw the fearful account that stood against them in the book of records and the terrible guilt that rested upon them for professing complete holiness while their daily acts were offensive in the sight of God. And some Life Sketches, pages 83 and 84, mostly 83, just a little bit of 84. So those are some things that perfection is not. Now, Just to give you some people's background thoughts about perfection, in the Oxford Dictionary of Christian Church, it says this about perfection of Christian character. It says, the primary meaning of the term is completeness. In an absolute sense, it may be attributed only to God. In an absolute sense. In the Old Testament, however, Job is described as a man that was perfect, Job 1:1. And in the New Testament, perfection is frequently enjoined on the Christian. According to Matthew chapter 5, verse 48, the perfection required of man is related to that of God. Be ye therefore perfect as your Father, as your Heavenly Father is perfect. And then a very well-known theologian, Hodges, in his series Systematic Theology in volume 3, page 253, says this specifically about Arminianism. Now, before I read this, let me just make sure that we understand what we're talking about. This is not Arianism. Do you understand Arminianism or what this means? It's sort of, if you have an understanding of Calvinism, the sovereignty of God and that God makes all the choices and you don't make any choices and you're destined to heaven or you're destined to hell, Arminianism is the opposite of that. Arminianism says that you have a choice, that you may choose salvation, that God has set salvation available to each one. Jacob Arminius. It says, the perfection which the Arminians teach is attainable, and which in many cases they say is actually obtained in this life, is declared to be complete conformity to the law, including freedom from sin and the proper exercise of all right affections and the discharge of all duties. Now Hodges, in his Systematic Theology, in the next page, has an interesting quotation from John Wesley I thought you might like. Wesley said, perfection is the loving God with all the heart, mind, soul, and strength. This implies that no wrong temper, none contrary to love, remains in the soul, and that all the thoughts, words, and actions are governed by love. That's what Wesley said. That's what Wesley said about it. I think that's pretty good. I think it's pretty close. So if everything I do should be governed by love, then if I'm getting ready to leave home, and I've just had a spat with my wife, I'm not going to look her in the face and say, I hope I shall never see your wicked face no more. I won't do that. Would I? That wouldn't be right to do, would it? No. No. Everything must be governed by love. And if it's not, friends, it's not perfection. In Psalms 45. Psalms 45. Verses 6 and 7 here are quoted in the book of Hebrews by Paul. Thy throne, O God, is forever and ever a scepter. The scepter of thy kingdom is a right scepter. And then verse 7, thou lovest righteousness and hated iniquity or wickedness. Therefore God, thy God, hath anointed thee with the oil of gladness above thy fellows. He loved righteousness and he hated iniquity, he hated wickedness. If we're to be Christ-like, friends, and that's really where we should be and where we must be. We must learn to love righteousness, to love that which is true and pure and holy and lovely, to be able to see the beauty of holiness. There is a beauty of holiness. To see the wickedness that I am and the holiness that He is, and to seek for that perfection of heart. You know, the Bible speaks about a perfect heart. And that's what I need. I need a perfect heart. I don't need a fixed up heart. That's why David, in his penitential prayer, said, Lord, he said, create me a clean heart. He didn't say, fix my old heart. Create a new process, a new heart. Because he had to have a perfect heart. And you can't take the old one and make it perfect. But he'll give you a new heart, a perfect heart. In Matthew chapter 19, we have a story about someone who we call the rich young ruler. He was a ruler. He was rich, and we're told also that he was young, so we call him the rich young ruler. In Matthew chapter 19, we have his story. And his story is also recorded in Mark chapter 10 and Luke chapter 18. But there's a little difference in the connection in Matthew that's not in Mark and Luke. One word, really, that's important, that's different to us. In Matthew 19, we'll begin in verse 16. And behold, one came and said unto him, Good master, What good thing shall I do that I may have eternal life? And he said unto them, Why callest thou me good? There is none good but one, that is God. If thou wilt enter into life, keep the commandments. He saith unto him, Which? Jesus saith, Thou shalt do no murder. Thou shalt not commit adultery. Thou shalt not steal. Thou shalt not bear false witness. Honor thy father and thy mother, and thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself. And the young man saith unto him, All these things have I kept from my youth up, but what lack I? And Jesus said unto him, If thou will be perfect. He doesn't say that in the other two Gospels, but he says it here. He says, if you'll be perfect, go sell all that you have, give it to the poor, come and follow me, and you'll have treasure in heaven. And he's telling him a principle here. And that principle is, very simply, that if we want to be perfect, we must be willing to give up everything that we have. And that we must love God most and love God supremely. And tonight, we can begin this week of study on character perfection by dedicating our lives totally. He may not be asking us to sell everything we have tonight, but he's asking us to be willing to. He's asking us to be willing to give up everything that we have and everything that we are and who we are for him. And this is where we start on the road to perfection tonight. I'd like to read to you a little section from the Bazaar of Ages on page 203 as we're preparing to close. And this is beautiful. Please take this to heart. I don't need to comment on it. Of ourselves, we are no more capable of living a holy life than was the impotent man capable of walking. There are many who realize their helplessness and who long for that spiritual life which will bring them into harmony with God. They are vainly striving to obtain it. In despair they cry, O wretched man that I am, who shall deliver me from this body of death? Romans 7:24 margin. Let these desponding, struggling ones look up. The Savior is bending over the purchase of his blood, saying with inexpressible tenderness and pity, Wilt thou be made whole? He bids you arise in health and peace. Do not wait to feel that you are made whole. Believe his word, and it will be fulfilled. Put your will on the side of Christ. Will to serve him, and in acting upon his word, you will receive strength. Whatever may be the evil practice, the master passion which through long indulgence binds both soul and body, Christ is able and longs to deliver. He will impart life to the soul that is dead in trespasses, Ephesians 2:1. He will set free the captive that is held by weakness and misfortune and the chains of sin. Can you believe that tonight? In 1 Corinthians chapter 15 and verse 57, the Apostle Paul says, But thanks be to God which giveth us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. We can have the victory tonight, friends. We can have the victory tonight. Now, are we going to be fully mature tonight? If I give my life fully to Christ, will I be fully mature tonight? Well, I probably won't be. You might be, but I probably won't be. Because we need to understand, friends, that this process goes deeper than we might think on the surface. Today I might come to Jesus, offer him all that I am. Lord, this is me. You can have every bit of me. He says, Alan, here's a place that you've been a little negligent in the past. Oh, Lord, I'm sorry. I didn't see that. But now I see it. Thank you for showing this. Now help me to walk that way. He says, I'm going to do that for you, Alan. I'm going to do it today. We're going to walk that way today. And so at that moment, in my sphere that I'm living in, I'm perfect in Christ. But friends, the problem is that's not all that there is to me. There's a lot more in me that because God is not going to overwhelm me and discourage me, he hasn't shown it to me yet. He's going to wait until tomorrow. He's going to show me something new tomorrow. After I get over this thing today and get this besetting sin conquered today, he's going to come back tomorrow. He's going to say, well, we had a good little walk yesterday, but I got to show you about something else that's happening in your life today. There's more? Oh, yes, there's more. And so he's going to show me something else tomorrow. But somewhere down the line, friends, whenever my work is finished on this earth and God's work is finished in me, I will be mature. And I, you know, we as Adventist people, and because of our Armenian theology and background, we cringe at the concept sometimes of once saved, always saved, don't we? And this concept of the eternal security of the believer, as sometimes some of our Baptist friends call it. But I do believe, friends, that if we truly are walking as best that we know it, at one with Christ, that he will preserve our life and he will not allow us to be destroyed until we have become the mature fruit that he wants us to be. Whatever he has chosen for us to be, he will never allow death. He will never allow anything to take us until we are ready. He is able. As you remember reading from the book, Letters to the Churches by M. Andreasen, he said, I am immortal till my work is finished. But if I could paraphrase Andreasen just a little more exact, I think, I am immortal until God's work is finished in me. And God will do that work if we will surrender our lives, turn over everything that we have and all that we are to him, and we can be his and we can walk wholly thine with him.